You can hear it in the wind as it blows through the trees. You can see it in the wings of a bird flying free. You can see it in a flower as it reaches for the sky. Every ocean praises Yahweh in overwhelming signs. So let's sing hallelujah, let's sing hallelujah, let's sing hallelujah, let's sing. Let's sing hallelujah, let's sing hallelujah, let's sing. Hallelujah, let's sing. His creation is a masterpiece no artist could touch. Oh no, no. Every color that he painted it with love. And his signature is seen on everything he made. Even you, for every breath you breathe his living name. So let's sing hallelujah, let's sing hallelujah, let's sing hallelujah, let's sing. Come on everyone, let's sing. So let's sing hallelujah, let's sing hallelujah, let's sing hallelujah, let's sing, 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 let's sing hallelujah, let's sing hallelujah, let's sing hallelujah, let's sing.
Hallelujah. Good morning, class.
Good morning.
My name is Martin Love, and I'll be your moderator for this morning session. Welcome. This is a school and not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. Since then, we've established various branch schools throughout the United States and in various parts of the world. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of the Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that there are lords many and God's meaning. But we now know that each Lord must have a name, and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. That means Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name, a minor investigation on your part in a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any characters in their or letters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah or Jah are impossible renderings of the true and original name of our Father and His Son. Christ, it is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, he is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape or form. We have drawn this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form. Form right within himself as Elohim. This is the word or son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having a shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now, there is only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. The simple yet intelligent question that we should all ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by a divine pattern of the universe. It is called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. Yahweh instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. The pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The aims of our school are as follows. The 10 aims of our school are as follows. 1, to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. 2, to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood. 3, in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. 3, to investigate the unexplained spirit law or so-called law of nature and the powers latent in man. 4. To encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. 5. To extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. 6. To learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. 7. To discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. 8. To earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. 9. To make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. 10. To inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. Today, we're going to do a little something different in regards to our video watch, and we hope that you will enjoy. We will have a prayer this morning, followed by a song, and then we'll have a scripture reading of 2 Corinthians, the 10th chapter. For our prayer, may we have Vercel Mack. Vercel, Dr. Mack.
Thank you. Good morning and good afternoon, brethren. Let's bow our hearts and mind in a moment of prayer. Heavenly Father Yahweh, we thank you for allowing us to gather one more time to learn anything about your pattern, your purpose, and your plan. We thank you, Father, for your grace. We thank you for all things. We thank you for delivering us from the darkness. You've delivered us from the darkness into your glorious kingdom. We're so grateful and we're so thankful for that. There is nothing that we can do without you. You have given us an understanding of what's going on in the world. And with your love, we understand. And we stand strong and we stand firm. Thank you for endurance. Thank you for long suffering. Without you, we can't do anything. And we are really grateful for that. We have all faith and all confidence because you've shown us. You've shown us the truth. And you are, if you're with us, Father, no one can be against us. So we thank you and we appreciate for everything. We sincerely appreciate you and thank you, Father. We're most humble. All of these things and much more, we thank you for through your only begotten Son, Yahshua the Messiah, our Savior. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Good morning, class. Our scripture lesson for this morning will be 2 Corinthians, the 10th chapter, page 245. And I'll be reading out of the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Trainer, Scripture Research Association, Incorporated. 2 Corinthians. Sorry. Now I saw myself beseech you by the meekness and gentleness of the Messiah, who in presence am based among you, but being absent am bold toward you. But I beseech you that I may not be bold when I am present with that confidence, wherewith I think to be bold against some, which think of us as if we walk according to the flesh. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapon of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through Elohim to the pulling down of strongholds of rebels, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of Yahweh, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of the Messiah, and being in readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. Do ye look on things after the outward appearance? If any man trusts to himself that he is of the Messiah, let him of himself think this again, that as he is of the Messiah, even so are we of the Messiah. For though I should boast somewhat more of our authority, which Yahweh has given us for edification and not for your destruction, I should not be ashamed, that I may not seem as if I would terrify you by letters. For his letters, say they, are weighty and powerful, but his bodily presence is weak and his speech contemptible. Let such one think this, that such as we are in word by letters, when we are absent, such will we be also indeed when we are present. For we dare not make ourselves of the number or compare ourselves with some that commend themselves, but they, measuring themselves by themselves and comparing themselves among themselves, are not wise. But we will not boast of things beyond our measures, but according to the measure of the rule which Yahweh has distributed to us, a measure to reach even unto you. For we boast not ourselves beyond our measures, as though we reach not unto you. For we are come as far as to you also in preaching the gospel of the Messiah, not boasting of things without our measure, that is, of other men's labors, but having hope when your faith is increased, that we shall be enlarged by you according to our rule abundantly. To preach the gospel in the regions beyond you, and not to boast in another man's field of endeavor made ready for our hand. But he that glorieth, let him glory in Yahweh, for not he that commended himself is approved, but whom Yahweh commended. I have read 2 Corinthians, the 10th chapter. Let us all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Dr. Mack and Dr. Reiser, for that. So this afternoon, we'll be playing two videos. One will go right into the other, and that should conclude about our time at the end. And we'll have the doxology at the end of the second video. Again, the link to the first video is in the chat box. So if in case you wanted to listen to that, and this lecture, this interview actually by Dr. Will Williams first, and then we'll go right into the second speaker, which will be announced through the video. So with no further to do, I'll get this set up.
Our guest today is Dr. Stephen Brooks. He is the Dean of the Ontario Branch of IDMR. And Stephen, first I'd like to say welcome to the Learning Tree.
And thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here.
Good. Panoramic visions, different names and titles, tabernacle pattern. What are we really talking about here?
Well, when a man decides truly in his heart and mind to be sincere within himself about wanting to know who he really is and who the Father really is, who the Creator is, with that ultimate feeling inside of him that he needs to have answered, the questions that are running around inside of the man, and he's looking for the answers as to how he can live in this life and be at peace with himself, Yahweh makes it available for him to receive those answers. Dr. Kinley was a vessel that was used in that Dr. Kinley did receive a divine vision and a revelation, and it was given to him in the year of 1931. Now, in receiving this stupendous vision and revelation, Dr. Kinley was asked, what will you do with this information? What will you do with this divine vision and revelation now that you've received it? Dr. Kinley stated that he would share it with his fellow man. Therefore, the Kinley Institute was established, and from that we have the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research Incorporated, the schools that are all over the world. One of the magnificent features of the school is that we basically teach from charts and tables, if you will, stated over there in Habakkuk 2 and 2. Showing forth that Yahweh answered me and said, write the vision and make it plain upon tables that everyone may read it fluently. Dr. Kinley pondered for several years, wondering how to bring this vision out and to be able to explain it to mankind where it would be accepted and understood. And in that, the charts were established. The charts allow us to bring people into a setting and to explain the Bible's history. This is the Moses chart here, and it shows forth the 7 days of the creation. It shows forth Yahweh in pure spirit. It shows forth the Elohim, which is the word, our son, and Yahshua the Messiah. And as you see, I am using the names that most people are not familiar with in today's society. I think Yahweh is a little more familiar. Elohim probably isn't, and Yahshua is starting to come into being focused on quite a bit amongst the churches. Now, Yahweh is pure spirit, and in the pure spirit state, he is incomprehensible and inscrutable. Yahweh is the name of the Father, the Heavenly Father, and it has been substituted by the name of Lord. Elohim is the word or son, or is the divine title. This also basically has been substituted by the name of God. We teach by the true names and title of the Heavenly Father to bring a man into an understanding of who the Father is and how he actually exists in the man, you see. Now, Yahshua is the name of the Holy Spirit. A lot of people don't realize that the Holy Spirit does have a name, you see. And yet, the Holy Spirit is manifested in or out of a man. Mm-hmm. Now, Yahshua has been erroneously substituted by the name of Jesus Christ. I wanted to bring that out, first of all, because it's important that we understand the true names and titles of the Heavenly Father, because they're extremely significant. Mm-hmm. In order for you to have an intimate relationship or to truly know your Father as he truly is and actually exists, we need to know a name. We need to be familiar. Mm-hmm. We need to be comfortable within that. And in Yahweh alone, you breathe that name. You inside of your hand, in your body, there's all sorts of witnesses to show that the name Yah, you know, resides within the man's very makeup.
Okay, now someone may ask, well, what difference does it make? I mean, we're all talking about the same creator. I mean, certainly, I mean, if this is a divine being and he's omnipotent and omniscient, I mean, surely he knows who I'm talking to. Would that be a fair question? How would you respond to that?
There were many gods, you see. There are many gods, and what we have to be careful of is that we're talking and addressing the proper God, okay? And first of all, Yahweh is the pure spirit. There is a unity of the spirit, and there is only one spirit. But there were many deities down in Egypt. Mm-hmm. And what we have to do is realize that if we are addressing a particular deity, then there's no power behind that. What we want to do is have an intimate relationship with the true Heavenly Father And there is quite a bit of difference in just saying, he knows who I'm talking about. Let's give an example. For instance, my name, your name is Willie. Mm. Now, if I decided to address you as Charles, after a while you would say to me, well, no, my name is not Charles, it's William or Willie, whichever you would prefer. But that is your name. Mm-hmm. In order for me to be true friends with you, I need to have a relationship with you. Therefore, I need to address you by your proper name, you see. And in that, as time goes along, we become friends, and we become very close friends. But if I never knew your true name, or didn't care to really know it and to become a true friend with you, therefore, we couldn't establish a friendship. We can't establish a link between one another so that we have communication. And therefore, the Father has made it known. See, the name Yahweh was not known unto man, unto the under patriarchs, up until 2,500 years after the birth of Adam, you see. Mm-hmm. And it was given to Moses first on Mount at the burning bush, mm-hmm. which would be over there in Exodus 3 and 2. Mm-hmm. And at that time, the name Yahweh was given to Moses, you see. Mm-hmm. And Moses did ask for a name because there were many deities and gods down in Egypt. Egypt, during that time, they worshipped many gods. I mean, the River Nile was a god, oh, sure. you see. Mm-hmm. So what we're saying is what we want to do is be specific. We want to know our Heavenly Father. We want to have that intimate relationship, and we want to know Him as He truly is and how He actually exists.
Okay, now you mentioned earlier about the unity of the Spirit. How mm-hmm. does that compare with the general teaching in Christianity, where it talks about the Trinity? Is there a difference there?
Well, if I may, I'd like to just quote a scripture coming out of the Bible. And we do use this is the Holy Name Bible, which are the names, the true names kept, but it's written by A.B. Trainer, mm-hmm. Which is not affiliated with our school, but we use it as a tool. We also use the King James Bible, and we use the Scofield Teaching Teacher's Bible. Now, this particular scripture is Ephesians 4:4, and it says, I'll pick it up at 3. It says, we're endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bonds of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, even as ye are called in one hope of your calling, one Elohim, one faith, one immersion. One is Yahweh and the Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. So we have to be careful about a Trinitarian concept. You see, man is a unity, just like the Father is a unity. He is the archetype pattern of the universe, okay? Therefore, we study by the tabernacle pattern. This pattern was given to Moses on Mount Sinai when he went up the first time. Because Moses did make 3 trips up to the mount. Not many people know that. But we do teach this. We are a Bible Research Institute. This is a school. We are not a church, and we're not affiliated with any other religious organization. Mm-hmm. This tabernacle pattern is the key to unlock all the mysteries and esoteric secrets of the scriptures.
So what is the origin of this tabernacle pattern that you mentioned?
This origin basically illuminates from Elohim himself. He is the archetype pattern of the universe, a superincorporeal being having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. Mm-hmm. Now, Yahweh allowed Moses to go up into the mount and to see the Elohim transform into every day of the creation. In that, he started with a tabernacle pattern, showing forth that Elohim is the original pattern of the universe, being one, showing forth a head region, a chest region, and an abdominal region, or the Father, the Word, or the Holy Spirit. Also, the most holy place, the holy place, and a court around about. This tabernacle was given to as a pattern to basically show Moses that if the pattern was correctly, if he followed the pattern properly, that the children would be able to worship Yahweh on a daily basis, because Yahweh would the cloud would settle right down over the most holy place, and he would reside with the people while they were camped in the wilderness of Sinai for 40 years.
Okay, so now you say this Elohim is the archetype of the original pattern of the universe. Are there any reflections in the universe that would point to this original pattern.
Yes, everything comes according to the pattern, even the man. We have a head region, we have a chest region, and we have an abdominal region, but we're one. We have the earth, we have the sky, we have the water, earth, and we have the sky, okay, or the moon. We have the yesterday, today, and tomorrow. We have water. Water comes in three forms, but one. Basically, we have water comes in a liquid form, it comes in a gas form, and it comes in a solid form. I'm saying that everything has the unity of the spirit, meaning that there are three, but these three bear witness in one. Okay?
Mm-hmm. Okay, so now we're reading here. Now we're reading in the Old Testament about Moses and this tabernacle pattern. What about the rest of the Bible, as far as it conforming to what this pattern is dictating and these names, and as far as like say the Book of Revelations, how would that fit in with what we've been discussing as far as this tabernacle?
John on the Isle of Patmos wrote the Book of Revelations, and John, the Book of Revelations is showing forth an account of John looking back into the books of the Bible, and Moses' vision is showing forth looking from the beginning to the end. So they are both two witnesses, the law and the prophet, looking at the same thing, okay? We need to have two witnesses to show forth whether or not something is true or not. And to make it extremely simple, John's vision was answering all the questions and going back into the wilderness of Sinai according to the times that the children were journeying through their the wilderness of Sinai for some odd 40 years.
Mm-hmm. Well, how did, well, answer me this, since we're talking about the Old Testament, mm-hmm. how did these Israelites get here to Egypt in the first place?
The Israelites basically ended up in Egypt because of the a covenant that Yahweh set forth with Abraham, in that Abraham's seed would be evilly mistreated for some 400 years, but that his seed would receive the promise, and all of his children would be blessed. Well, now Abraham came out of the land of Ur, and he resided over here in Canaan's land. And he did start in Canaan's land. You see, Yahweh did not give him anything at that particular point, but his seed, which would reside from Jacob's seed, which had the 12 patriarchs, did have to journey down into the land of Egypt because of a famine that happened up here in Canaan's land, you see. Now, when the children got down here for some 400, in the beginning, the 70 patriarchs that came out of Canaan's land, they were down here, and they were treated very well. They did receive the land of Goshen, which they were grazing sheep at the time, because Pharaoh and the Egyptians were cattle herders. So, but nevertheless, they gave them the land of Goshen. Well, after 400 years, the Pharaoh that did know Joseph, he died, and all the individuals that did know of Joseph died off, and there became a new king, you see. I just kind of chopped that up because I realized that we don't have a lot of time. Right. But I wanted to basically say that it was Joseph that was sold into bondage that came down here, and he was down here for 17 years. He was sold by his brothers down into bondage to go down into Egypt. He was down there for 17 years, but he became the second man in command, the book of Genesis does give a complete outline as to what the different events that took place. But to make that story more or less shorter than what I'd like to go into, that is how the Israelites got down in here into Egypt. Okay. And then the track is to show forth that our origin is our destination. In other words, we came out of Canaan's land. We came already out of the promised land. And what we're showing forth is how we had to go down into bondage for 400 years, according to Yahweh's purpose, and how we ended up coming back into Canaan's land, or the land of milk and honey.
So,
Jerusalem.
So you're suggesting that this migratory trek is really a metaphor for our lives. It's showing forth how we, mentally and spiritually speaking, we descend and ascend.
That's correct.
According to our knowledge. Could you just briefly explain to me, Moses is credited with writing the first five books of the Bible, but yet a lot of people haven't explained or elucidated how that came about. How did Moses come about writing the book of Genesis?
Well, Moses came about by writing the book of Genesis through Moses was taken up into the mount. Over in the book of Exodus, we have Exodus 24 and 17. Is that we pick it up where Moses is going up into the mount. Now, when Moses went up into the mount, he was up there for 40 days. Mm-hmm. Well, the first 7 days that he was up there, basically he was shown the the information on how to the 7 days of the creation. Okay, he spent another 33 days up there showing forth the information on how to build this pattern here, mm-hmm. On how to build the tabernacle itself. Moses's account shows forth in the book of Genesis that it's his vision, in where he was actually shown the 7 days of the creation. Yahweh showed him every day of the creation on how it came into being. So therefore, Moses had to see the vision and come into an understanding. And actually, the book, the Bible, really should start over in Exodus. It shouldn't start in Genesis.
So you're saying that when the Bible says in the beginning, in the book of Genesis, we're not talking about in the beginning of creation. We're talking about
in the beginning of Moses' vision.
I see.
That's what we're talking about.
And you say that he received it when and where?
Moses received this.
His vision.
This vision in Exodus 24, basically going forth, explaining to Moses after he went up into the mount the first time, mm-hmm. and he was there for 40 days. This is when he received the vision.
Okay. So now, if you could explain to me, we want to keep up with the theme of our topic, the unity of the Spirit. Explain to me how Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua are one, or the unity as far as their manifestation. You know, could you kind of go into that for a moment?
Yahweh is pure spirit, mm-hmm. and in the pure spirit state, he is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. Yahweh is the ultimate of intelligence, wisdom, knowledge, love, beauty, justice, foundation, power, and strength. Now, Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form right within himself as Elohim. This is the word, our son, a super incorporeal being having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form of Elohim can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Now, later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself into a physical body as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world called Jesus Christ, you see.
So really, we're not talking about three individuals here or three personalities.
Not at all. Not at all. We're talking about a unity of the spirit, the self-same. In other words, you're Willie, and you're a father, you're a son, and you're a brother. You have three different manifestations, more or less, or three different ways of presenting yourself, but you're still one individual. Is that correct?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Hmm. Okay. Could you perhaps go into a little bit, this person, Yahshua Messiah, who everyone seems to know as Jesus Christ, what was he about? What was his mission?
Yahshua the Messiah's mission was to come in and to fulfill the old covenant, or to fulfill what we would consider the law and the prophets, so that we might come into a salvation without any works, you see. In other words, under the law, Moses and the children received the law, and they had 613 statutes, commandments, and judgments. Okay. And under the law, they practiced cardinal ordinances under the Old Testament, you see. And this law had to be done to the T. If you broke one law, then you had broken all of them. In other words, there was no way that a man could actually fulfill this cardinal ordinance. Let's say, for instance, on the 10th day, the 8th day, a man had to be circumcised.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, if on the eighth day a man had to be circumcised and it fell on the Sabbath, well, on the Sabbath a man could do nothing. He had to just stay at home and rest. If circumcision of the child fell on the eighth day, then there was no way that that could be fulfilled, because he was either going to have to circumcise him according to the law, or he was going to break the law by doing something on the Sabbath day. So how could it be fulfilled? Well, this was nailed to the cross at the death of the Messiah. And instead, now we have something that's written far more better. It's written over there in Jeremiah 31 that the law, the Ten Commandment law, the 613 law, statutes, commandments now are going to be written in your heart and mind. In other words, a man knows when he's doing something wrong right now. You don't have to go to anything to look it up to find out whether or not I'm breaking this particular law. I mean, under the law, you had individuals that would write the different laws all over their clothes. They wrote it over in their homes. They had it on the mantles of the door, because they were so worried about breaking a law that they spent most of their time trying to follow the law to the T. Whereas now it's written in your heart and in your mind. It's not written on stones. It's written in your heart and in your mind.
Hmm. Very interesting. Mm-hmm. Well, Stephen, I thank you for coming out today. It was very enlightening.
Thank you.
And we hope that everybody at home was enlightened also.
For our first speaker of this evening, we'd like to call on from our downtown Chicago branch, Dr. Kenny Spiro. Excuse me, I'm sorry, from Dr. Lee Warren. Good evening. And I'm always glad to be here to give a reasonable testimony of the vision and revelation given to us by our founder, Dr. Henry C. Kinley, in year June 6, 1931. See? And for those of you that are new and those of us that have been around some time, we don't have many more of these gatherings here in the flesh, see? And by that I mean, as you begin to look at that transpires here in the earth plane, the times or the signs of the times, as the Messiah talked about in the 24th chapter of Matthew, see? Now, whether you're an atheist, or agnostic, or whatever your beliefs are, you know, just from a carnal, natural standpoint, see? You know something is very wrong in earth plane, see? See? And the world governments and world religions have no answer to that's taking place in the earth plane, see? Now, would somebody get me the 17th chapter of Revelation, see? And we'll begin there, see? Now, what you see pictorially illustrated on these charts is a result of a divine vision and revelation, see? Given to us by Dr. Henry C. Kinley in the year June 6, 1931. And what this vision reveals, see? It revealed that God himself, or the creator himself, Yahweh Elohim, whom the world calls Lord or God, or God himself, is a universal spirit pattern. See, He himself is a pattern. Everything in the whole universe, see, it's fashion or made after this pattern, see. Now, this vision that we're looking at, see, of Dr. Henry C. Kennedy, it's a panoramic vision, meaning it encompasses both Moses' vision, see, and John's vision on the Isle of Patmos in AD 96, see. And this is some 63 years, John's book, the book of Revelation, written by the Apostle John, see, as he's seen there on the Isle of Patmos. 63 years after the Messiah's death, burial, and resurrection, see, John is the last eyewitness held over for a witness, see. And what he beholds is a woman sitting on a scarlet-colored beast, see, and she had this golden cup in her hand, see. And as we read the first five or six verses, he goes on to explain that the nations of the world, earth, had been made drunk with the wine of her fornication, see, or mad or drunk, see. See, now, first of all, when you're examining that, that's a vision being shown to John, see. And the beast that he's talking about, see, that's not something natural. It's allegorical and symbolical, see. And it cannot be taken literally, see. Now, what you have here throughout the world, especially here in America, you have an epidemic of drugs, see. And somebody give me Romans 1, 19 and 20, see. That is permeating the whole world, see. Drugs. Everybody's on drugs, one form or another, you know, especially. And people have no answer, see, to that that's taking place, see. Now, you have a natural body, which Dr. Harris went in last night, see. You have a natural body here, see, that we all have, see. And there's no questions about that. If you don't believe, just walk out in front of a car and you find out if you have a natural little physical body. No debate and equivalent about this. But this natural body that we have, see, it can be made drunk. In other words, it consists of nine systems, see. And by putting various intoxicated beverages, you know, alcohol or various drugs, cocaine, marijuana, whatever, this body can be made drunk, see, say from a natural standpoint, see, that really impairs the judgment, see. And here in America, you know, some 50,000 people drive every year, see, don't drive and drink, see. But yet people go ahead and just go through that, thinking that in that state and condition, coordination is impaired just from a natural standpoint, see? Now you have a natural body that's pointing to a what? A spiritual body or a soul, see? Now that soul can be made drunk, just as drunk or even worse so, see, than the natural little physical body, see? Now, the problems that you see in the world, see, the natural drugs is pointing to spiritual drugs. We're talking about erroneous doctrine. See, that have made people mad. You know, you find people that have been drunk, they're walking out with no shoes on, urinating in the telephone booth, you know, asking what they're doing. They think they're at home. You see what I'm saying? Man's drunk, see? See? Now, what we're talking about, you've seen those various types of behavior when people got drunk, you know?
Yep.
See? Now, that's from a natural standpoint. Judgment's impaired. It's faculties. It's messed up. You've been everywhere, you know everything. Can't nobody, you can't tell a drunk man nothing.
That's
see?
True.
I've been everywhere and known everything. Seen everything. People say, well, how you know? Because I've been drunk. See? Both naturally,
wow.
See? And spiritually, see? See? Now, give me Romans 1, 19 and 20, we can get into it. See?
Romans 1,
see.
19 and 20.
Read.
Because that which may be known of Yahweh is
that may be known of Yahweh. There's something that can be surely known of Yahweh. Read.
Is manifest in them.
Now, listen, it's manifested in those what? Those children of Israel, mm-hmm. See? Or the seed of Abraham, Yahweh revealed his divine oracle, see, his laws, see, he fashioned a tabernacle in the divine order of services was given to the Hebrews, or Jews and Jews only, see, was not revealed, see, or given to any Gentile. Now, within these laws and oracles, see, were hidden the mysteries of Yahweh. See, read.
For Yahweh has shown it unto them.
Unto the Israelites, read.
For the invisible things of him.
Now, listen, the invisible things of Yahweh.
From the creation of the world.
And listen, the invisible things of Yahweh from the creation of the world, read.
Are clearly seen.
Now they are clearly seen. Read.
Being understood.
That being understood.
By the things that are made.
Listen, they are being understood by the things that are made. Now you say, what things are made? See, you got a whole universe that's made. See? You got a physical body that's being made. See? And Yahweh himself, see, has given specification, see, for three things to be made. Mm-hmm. See? He told man, Noah's Ark, this tabernacle, and Solomon's temple and Zerubbabel. Those are things were all threefold by this pattern, see? Now, so in other words, it takes the natural things, see, to understand the various spiritual things, see? There's a natural death, see, of the physical body, see? Type, shadow, and allegory of a spiritual death, which we'll talk to, see? That's the death of an inner man's soul, see? See, now one is visible and one is invisible. The reality is invisible, see? But there's a natural literal manifestation. There's natural deafness. It points to spiritual deafness, see? See? And as we're talking about, there is natural drunkenness, see? That is pointing to spiritual drunkenness. Drunkenness in the spirit that impairs, see what? What does it impair? It impairs these nine divine attributes, the judgment, see? As you have it naturally manifested, see? As these systems are impaired, see, by physical drugs, you know, that are placed in coordination is going off, see? See, you have the nervous system being, everything is impaired here, see? Everything is being impaired here, whereas these nine divine attributes of a man's soul, they are being impaired too by erroneous doctrine, see? See? And this is only temporal, see? See? But this here is eternal, see? See? And that's the reality, see? Now, we go into John, see? See, the 17th chapter, and the reason we're going into it, see, people say, well, what is the cause of all this wickedness and confusion and strife in airplanes, see? Some people say, well, it's the blacks out there selling drugs, see? Or the cocaine experts. Like, everybody's putting the problem on everything other than the doctrine, see? See, that has been espoused by Christendom or Mystery Babylon, and men have been made, what? Drunk by the wine of our fornication, see? Now, there's this natural drunkenness. You say, well, then what does that mean? Now, we're going to go back into the Law and the Prophets and give you an interpretation of that, see? See? And then we'll proceed on to talk about this new creature, see? See? Which is, we all should, as Paul said, examine ourselves and see whether we be in the faith, see? Because, see, we're down at an end of time, see? See, we've come to actually the end, which I will discuss if time will allow, see? Now read the 17th chapter of Revelation.
Revelation 17 and 1.
Read.
And there came one of the seven angels, which had the seven vials.
Read.
And talked with me.
Read.
Saying unto me, come hither, I will show unto thee the judgment of the great whore that sitteth upon many waters.
Read.
With whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication.
Now listen, the kings of the earth have committed fornication. Now he's not talking naturally. So this one woman said, the kings of the earth. Now, it is impossible for this one woman to have this kind of sex with all the kings of the earth. So it's not talking what? Naturally or carnal. See, it's allegorically and symbolical. Read.
And the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication.
Now, listen, the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine, see, of her fornication. Read on.
So he carried me away in the spirit.
Now, John said he was carried away in the spirit. In other words, he's on this island, completely surrounded by water on the seventh day. Now he's at the end, see, looking at the Yahweh's purpose from end back to the beginning to confirm, see, Moses' vision. See? Which is Moses is seeing the purpose of Yahweh from the beginning to the end, see. Now at this late date and time, see, Christendom is still phantom with trying to wrestle the mysteries, see. Or try to understand John's vision, and John was an unlearned man. See? And still the great men or theologians cannot understand what is taking place there, see, in John's vision and explain it in its utter simplicity. Read.
So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness.
Read.
And I saw a woman.
Now that wilderness, see, being likened to the holy place. But go ahead, read.
And I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast,
read.
Full of names of blasphemy,
read.
Having seven heads and ten horns.
Having said seven heads and ten horns, read.
And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color.
Now that woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color, read.
And decked with gold and precious stones.
Read.
And pearls. Having a golden cup in her hand.
That golden cup that she has, that's, you know, the cup that they use in the Holy Eucharist. But what it's talking about spiritually is the doctrine, see, that's been expounded, see, by Mystery Babylon. See, read.
Full of abominations.
That's full of abomination. Read.
And filthiness.
See?
Of her fornication.
Read.
And upon her forehead was a name written. Mystery Babylon, the the Great.
Mystery Babylon the Great reads,
the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth.
Now see, the nations of the earth have been made drunk by the wine of what? Fornication, see? Mm-hmm. See, that golden cup. So we have to understand then, what is this principle of drunkenness and how can we arrive at a correct interpretation of what John is seeing, see? See, now Isaiah confirms with this. See, now Isaiah says, to the law and to the prophecy. If they speak not according to this word, see, there is no light or there is no illumination in them, see? Now we go back to the law, see? And we will understand, see, what is truly taking place spiritually and psychologically in the earth plane, see? See, now the world will not believe the words of the Messiah as the Messiah's mission is, or as they call him, Jesus Christ, see? Now give me Matthew 5:17 and 18 and hold it. And also I want you to give me Deuteronomy 21 and 20. And somebody give me Jeremiah 23 and 9. Now Moses talks about this principle of being drunken. See what I'm saying? See, now we pick it up back in the law. See, we're going to show it in the prophecy and in the fulfillment. Then we come to some conclusion of the thing, see, that he's really not talking about somebody that's naturally physically drunk. See, he's talking about somebody that has been made spiritual drunk, see? See, by denying the purpose or the mission of Yahshua Messiah, see, Christendom or the whole world said that Jesus Christ, see, instituted water baptism and Lord's Supper. These carnal waters, see, that was given to Jews and Jews only, see, they have been dragged over into this present kingdom age of grace, where you're supposed to be saved by grace through faith, not a work, at least any man should boast. See, and what they have done, they have dragged these ordinances over, see, and the doctrine, see, and what these things have done, they have made men drunk, see, or these words have made men disobedient. See, it's impossible to worship Yahweh in spirit and in truth in this age, see, and then try to serve him, see, under these carnal ordinances, see. So you're being made drunk, see, spiritually and psychologically. In other words, that those words are damning your soul, are preventing the new creature, see, or the transformation that's taking place in you spiritually and psychologically. See, we're talking about that new creature, or those attributes in you to be quickened, or to resurrect it from a death-like state. Read.
Matthew 5:17. Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets.
Now the Messiah said it here, see, and you know, in the so-called New Testament, see. Now, when the Messiah is born, or when he's in his ministry now, you remember, he told the scribes and Pharisees, he said, now ye search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, and they are they that testify, me. Now, all these circumcision ceremonies, baptism, Passovers, sacrifices, Ten Commandment law, and tithing, now all this was part of this first covenant. See, the Jews, or the religious leaders, their interpretation that if they performed these ordinances, naturally, physically, that they had some form of righteousness or they had eternal life. He said, hey, you made a great error in your interpretation of the scriptures. Now remember, that book had been sealed. See, that John, see, I already said the book had seven seals. And who stepped forward to loosen the seals on what was the book? The book was the Law and Prophets, or what we call the Old Testament. See, it had been sealed, and no one knew the correct interpretation of that had been laid down therein. See? So your imposters were the scribes and Pharisees. So Israel, see, had been made drunk, see, by the scribes and Pharisees. See, read.
Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets.
He said, I didn't come to destroy the law or the prophets. Read.
I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill.
Wait a minute. He said, I come to fulfill. That means then all you got to do, see, now I taught Sunday school for 15 years in a Baptist church. See, went to college and never realized that the simple word fulfill. See, showing forth that we had been made all what? Drunk, spiritually and psychologically. See, we knew everything. Oh, that's a simple word. I don't need to look it up. I know what it fulfill means. See, it never dawned on us, see, until it was revealed by this vision and revelation.
That's right.
See, the serious dispensational error. See, that the Messiah had fulfilled and brought this first covenant to an end. And it's in this present kingdom age that we worship Yahweh in spirit and truth, right here in our own hearts and minds. See, this is the tabernacle where he's revealed in. Not in Vatican and not in Mecca or any other place. You see what I'm saying? But the nations had been made drunk. So Yahshua Messiah, he said he come to fulfill the law and prophets. Read.
For verily I say unto you,
till heaven and earth pass,
till heaven and earth pass,
one jot,
or one tittle,
shall in no wise pass from the law,
till it no wise pass from the law, till it's what?
Till all be fulfilled.
See, till all be fulfilled. So this law and prophets, see, was every bit of it was testifying, see, to Yahshua Messiah, see, fulfilling the things that would lay down therein, see. Now, we understand that the Messiah was fulfilling, see, and we begin to understand then let's understand the relationship to the fulfilled and the word institute. The Christian world said the Messiah is instituting water baptism and Lord's Supper, see. Mm-hmm. Now, if you believe that, we said you're going to be made drunk, see, spiritually and psychologically, and cause you to lose your soul as a man that's driving drunk. See, in a car, he said he could kill himself and somebody else. The blind lead the blind, and they all fall into what? A ditch, see. See, now, as we go on, see, now get me what the what Moses wrote in the law, Deuteronomy 21 and 20.
And they shall say unto the elders of his city, this our son is stubborn and rebellious.
Start back up about a couple of verses, get some continuity thought.
18.
Read.
If a man have a stubborn and rebellious son.
Now see, under the law, so they didn't have this problem with juvenile delinquency, you know what I'm saying? A home for the wayward children. You know what I'm saying? When the state puts you up and you know that, ain't no juvenile land. I didn't have time to deal with that foolishness like that. See? See? If you can't behave, we got a way of getting rid of you real quick. See? Read. Read.
If a man have a stubborn and rebellious son.
Read.
Which will not obey the voice of his father or his mother.
Now he's talking about his natural father and mother. It's really pointing to the true father and mother. That's Yahweh Elohim.
That's right.
And those are the principles that are laid down in the law and in the prophecy. See? Read.
And when they have chastened him, he will not hearken unto them. Then shall his father and his mother lay hold on him.
Okay, that's what in other words, in today's society, see, if you have a child that you just don't whoop, you just can't do nothing with, he said, well, look, you take it down to the state. Say, look here, I can't handle this no more. Mm-hmm. And it's on you. You see what I'm saying? Because I ain't going to be bothered with it. You see what I'm saying? So they have a home for where with children. You know, the parents just can't put up with it no more. See, now they didn't have that under the law. See, this is what they did. Read. So the parent figured that the child would not obey them. Then they would take the child before the elders of the city. Read.
Then Joe's father and his mother lay hold on him.
Oh, they lay hold on him. Say, well, look here, Buster, we can't do nothing with you. We're going to take you on down to the elders. See, and they have a council there. Read.
And bring him out unto the elders of his city.
Read, the elders of the city. Read.
And unto the gate of his place.
Read.
And they shall say unto the elders of the city.
Now you listen very carefully to what's written in Moses wrote. Read.
This our son is stubborn and rebellious.
Now he's stubborn and he's rebellious. Read.
He will not obey our voice.
Now listen, he won't obey his natural parents, mother and boys. See, now if he's not going to obey his natural parents, mother and boys, he's no more his mother and spirit. Read.
He is a glutton and a drunkard.
Oh, now we understand what a drunkard and a glutton is. He wasn't talking about somebody with alcohol. We're just talking about somebody that's stubborn and what? Rebellious. So you can see then, by having the wine of Christendom in your heart and mind, people say, they're offended. See, by the doctrine that they teach, that salvation can be obtained by water baptism and Lord's Supper and the tithing, those things, by works. See, that's causing you to be what? Disobedient, see, or to disobey. Yahweh wants everybody to worship according to this new covenant, see? But as long as you got the doctrine of Christendom in you, see, it's preventing you, see, from worshiping Yahweh in spirit and in truth. Read.
And all the men of his city shall stone him with stones that he die.
Oh. We see. Okay. Now we have it in the law, see? Now let's go over to the prophecy. Jeremiah, I think it's 23 and 9.
Jeremiah 23:9.
Now see, Israel, see? See, had been made very drunk, see, which we'll get into in just a moment. Read.
Mine heart within me is broken.
Read.
Because of the prophets.
Read.
All my bones shake. I am like a drunken man and like a man whom wine hath overcome.
Read.
Because of Yahweh and because of the words of his holiness.
Read.
For the land is full of adulterers. For because of swearing, the land mourneth. The pleasant places of the wilderness are dried up, and their course is evil.
Okay, now he's talking about the land up here in Canaan's land that's full of adultery. Now, he's not talking about natural wife swapping up here and stuff running around. What he's talking about is all these idols, see, that the children of Israel had put up in high places here. They're worshiping everything under the sun, moon, and stars. So Yahweh said the land has been made drunken, see, That's what you have out here in the Christian world. They've been made drunk. And see, Yahweh makes them drunk spiritually. They're already drunk spiritually, so he gives them a natural manifestation. He has dope just running rampant through the country to show forth that they are what? Mm-hmm. They are drunk spiritually.
That's right.
See what I'm saying? All these drug problems. Wait, look, you're drunk spiritually. That's
right.
The reason why you have to have the natural manifestation is running so rampant. And there is no end to it. Read.
And their course is evil, and their force is not right. For both prophet and priest are profane. Yea, in my house have I found their wickedness, saith Yahweh.
Okay, then Yahshua Messiah comes in, and he explains what this drunkenness is in the last days. See, I think it's Matthew 24, I think it's about 45. The word says that Yahshua is a parable about the man that says that he delays his coming. And he begins to drink with his servants and beat and be a drunkard, see? Read. Now that's law, that's prophecy, that's the fulfillment, see? And then, and after that, get me Revelation 11 and 2, 11 and 1, and then get me Ezekiel 40 and 3. Read.
Say Matthew 24, 25?
45, I think it is.
Matthew 24, 45.
Read.
Who then is a faithful and wise servant, whom his master hath made ruler over his household?
Read.
To give them meat in due season.
Read.
Blessed is that servant whom his master, when he cometh, shall find so doing. Verily I say unto you, that he shall make him ruler over all his goods.
Well, go above that. Maybe it's 44.
I think it's coming down.
Okay, go ahead. I'm sorry.
Verily I say unto you, that he shall make him ruler over all his goods.
Read.
But if that evil servant shall say in his heart, my master delayeth his coming.
See, now the Messiah is already here. Now he's not going anywhere to be revealed. He'll just be revealed where he's already always been, in a hidden state. And when people find out, see, and when he's universally revealed in every eye, as John said, every eye, see, those that are in darkness, see, every eye, what do you mean, what every eye? Every eye shall see him and look upon him whom they have what? See, they have slain. See, people say, well, how have we slain Yahshua? By rejecting that he has fulfilled and brought this new covenant, this old covenant to what? To an end. See, they have crucified the Messiah afresh again by denying that he has come to fulfill this first covenant here. Read on.
And shall begin to smite his fellow servants and to eat and drink with the drunken.
Now, to eat and drink with the drunkens. See? Now, again, we're talking spiritually and psychologically. See? That is not going to do anything good for a man. See? Spiritually what? Psychologically. See? Oh, that's for the edification of the soul. See? And he's talking to me about the scribes and Pharisees and them rejecting, see, the true Son of Yahweh, which is Yahshua the Messiah. Now, let us go back and follow this principle in operation along with the migratory tract. But first of all, in order to determine drunkenness or doctrine, people say, well, how do we know that you're not teaching a lie? You know what I'm saying? I mean, we could be part of Mystery Babylon. See? Now, we have a pattern, see? Mm-hmm. See? And John, see, was given a reed, likened unto a rod, and he was told to measure the temple, mm-hmm. see, of Yahweh. See? People say, what's the temple of Yahweh? You mean St. Peter's Basilica or some church? No, he's talking about this here. This is the temple. Measure the temple and them that dwell or worship what? They ain't. See, now if they're not speaking according to this pattern, see, then you know that they've been made what? Drunk by the wine of the fornication. So you got to have some measuring rod. You know, see, like the officers will tell you, you got a car, would you please breathe into this little tube here? You see what I'm saying? And they would read you your constitutional rights, see? See? And if you don't, you know, in the state of Illinois, if you refuse the test, then you lose your license automatically. You see what I'm saying? See? Now, this is what we're talking about. See, we all have to come to realization, you know, are we drunk? See? Talking about spiritually and what? Psychologically. See? Read.
Revelation 11 and 1.
Read.
And there was given me a reed like a rod.
Now, this reed was given to unto John. Read on.
And the angel stood, saying, rise and measure the temple of Yahweh.
Now, he was told to rise and measure the temple of Yahweh. Read.
And the altar.
And the altar.
And them that worship therein.
See. Now, we're going to understand what that reed was, see, then we would have to go over again whatever Moses, John is seeing in his vision. See, it has to be confirmed by Moses and the what? And the prophets, see. Now, if it cannot be confirmed by Moses or the law and prophets, see, then that means that John's vision cannot substantiate it, see? Or you have not arrived at the correct interpretation of what John is seeing. Now we go to Ezekiel 40 and 3. Would somebody bring that blackboard up here, please? See? And then we can get on into the discourse here. See? And then Exodus 24, 9 and 10. I'll quote that. But read Ezekiel 40 and 3.
Ezekiel 40 and 3. And he brought me thither, and behold, there was a man whose appearance was like the appearance of brass.
Oh, now Ezekiel, see, if you read the first chapter of that, you can read this whole chapter when you go home, because it's talking about this man, see, and what type of appearance does he have? Read it again.
And he brought me thither, and behold, there was a man whose appearance was like the appearance of brass.
Like unto appearance of brass. This is the self-same man, see, or Elohim, that Moses is seeing in his vision. Now, he has a reed in his hand. See, we ain't got time to go into the whole thing, but you read in that 40th chapter, that 43, 44, this man is walking through this temple just measuring everything with this reed. See? Now, that's that self-same reed we're talking about that was given to what? John on the Isle of Patmos. Now, we ain't making up nothing. See, you got a Bible there. Read.
With a line of flax in his hand, okay. And a measuring reed.
And now, he has that, that's that measuring reed. Now, read on.
And he stood in the gate.
And he stood at the gate. Read.
And the man said unto me, Son of man, behold with thine eyes, and hear with thine ears.
Read.
And set thine heart upon all that I show thee.
Read.
For to the intent that I might show them unto thee, art thou brought thither.
Come on.
Declare all that thou seest to the house of Israel. And behold, a wall on the outside of the house, round about.
Read.
And in the man's hand, a measuring reed of 6 cubits
Hold.
Long.
That's all we want on that. See, that reed was what?
6 cubits.
See, it was 6 cubits long, see? And we know approximately, see, that a cubit is 18 inches. Mm-hmm. See? Or 1.5 what?
Feet.
See? So six times 1.5 gives you what?
No.
9 feet. See? Now that 9 is pointing to the 9 what? The 9 divine attributes that make up this spiritual embodiment. See? See? Now, Moses saw, so this man with this reed, see, is being also has to be confirmed by Moses. And see, Moses saw Moses, Aaron, Nadab, Abihu, and 70 the elders of Israel. See? Read it real quick, and then I'm ready to go.
Exodus 24, 9 and 10.
Read.
Then went up Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel. And they saw the Elohim of Israel.
Now see, they saw this Elohim of Israel. Read.
And there was under his feet, as it were, a paved work of a sapphire stone.
There was a paved work of a sapphire stone. Read.
And as it were, the body of heaven in its clearness.
Now it was a body of heaven in its clearness. Read.
And upon the nobles of the children of Israel, he laid not his hand. Also, they saw Elohim and did eat and drink.
Okay, now, he himself is a reed. Now, this tabernacle is a definition of this spiritual embodiment. And the last speaker that went in and showed you that this tabernacle is threefold. The show forth of this embodiment is threefold. The Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit in one embodiment, see? And you have 9 vessels in this tabernacle, see? Mm-hmm. See, because this is the brazen altar of sin sacrifice, the brazen laver, the brazen cup of holy anointing oil. Coming through this first veil here into the holy place, you have a 7-branch golden candlestick. You have a golden altar of incense. You have a table of shewbread. See, that's 3 and 3. That's 6. Then coming through the second veil into the most holy place, the holies of holies, see, where Yahweh said that he would dwell in a cloud above the mercy seat between the wings of the cherubim, see. So you have these 2 archangels on either side here, see. And Yahweh would dwell in a cloud. Now this mercy seat with the Ark of the Covenant, with the law therein, that's 1, see. And the 2 archangels is 3. So 3, 6, 9. 9 vessels in this tabernacle, see, corresponding, see. See, with the 9 systems in a man's body, see, see, which corresponds to the 9 divine attributes, see, that make up this spiritual embodiment, so we can understand what the true reed really is, see, Yahshua the Messiah, Yahweh Elohim. So now, Moses began to see the creation being measured by the pattern or by the reed, see, right. It's being formed and it's being what? Fashioned by the reed, see. Now we take this reed now, see, which is Elohim himself, and we begin to understand that he himself is the reed, the measuring reed, whereby all things are being formed, shaped, and animated, see? See? So we have this new creature, see, which Moses sees the creation by the pattern, see? And what you see then, and now get me Genesis 1 and 1 and Exodus 24, 16. So that when Moses sees the beginning of creation, see, now when you read Genesis 1 and 1, you start at Genesis 1 and 1, not realizing that Genesis, see, that's a vision being shown to Moses while he's atop of Mount Sinai in the year 1490 BY. And Moses is being shown the creation of the vision in 6 solar days. Now, it didn't take no 6 days to make the creation. It took place in the realm of eternity. See? See, and spirit, see, all matter is spirit what? Materialized. See? See, and it was being formed or fashioned by the pattern. See? And so when Moses saw the creation, see, in its beginnings, it was without any particular shape and form. See? See, to show forth what? That Yahweh in his pure spirit state is without any particular shape and form. Now, out of this parent mass that's completely surrounded by water, see, he's going to draw out the new what? The new creature is going to come forth. Come forth unto perfection. See? By what process? By the reed. How is that done? See? By death, burial, and what? Resurrection, and an ascension or fruition. So the creation is going to come forth, but when it originated in the beginning of Moses' vision, it was in a death-like state, or a death and burial state. See, this is parent mass completely surrounded by water, like the water in the labor. This dead earth has no life thereon, see? But there's the spirit of Elohim that's going to speak to this parent mass, see? And he's going to bring forth a new creature, see? Now it's being shown in the beginning of Moses' vision, because that's going to have to be fulfilled. So if how is this new creature, see, going to be brought forth? Well, the same way Moses saw it. It has to be spoken in, see? Now this come by what? Observation. By watching the sign, the hieroglyphics here, see? But the regeneration of this inner man, see? From that carnal state of mind, see? Or Egypt or Babylon, full of hate, malice, strife, all the works of the flesh. Now you in a death and burial state, see? And what's necessary is a what? A regeneration, see? See? Now it's being done by the pattern. Read real quick.
Genesis 1 and 1. In the beginning, Elohim created the heaven and the earth. And the earth was without form and void.
See, the earth was without form and void, read.
And darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the spirit of Elohim moved upon the face of the water.
Now, just leaving that there, that's a vision, see. Now, we're going to show forth that the migration correlates with that, see. Now, in the beginning of the children of Israel's migration, again, the migration being formed by the reed. See, it's Egypt, that's the court roundabout. The wilderness of Sinai is what? The holy place. And Canaan's land is the what? Most holy place. The river Jordan is the second veil. And the Red Sea, see, heaped up into a tunnel-like effect, represents the labor, but it's also an entranceway or a doorway from Egypt into the wilderness, see? Now we just watch how the children of Israel make this migration, see? See, they are the new creature that's going to be drawn out of this chaotic what? Dark. Now, when Moses then came back down here, Aaron came back down here with a rod or a reed.
Right.
See, and with that reed or rod that Moses with Joshua down, that smote Egypt. See, that's what we're doing. We're taking this reed here,
right,
and we'll smoke you. See, now we either transform you or damn you. See, just by this reed. See, which is the words of the Holy Spirit spoken by this pattern here. That it'll transform your consciousness if you believe it, and if you reject it, it just damns you just instantaneously. People say, well, I ain't withered and decrepit. Not yet. And that coming not by what? Not by observation. See, we're talking about that the decrepit old man, see, which we'll pick up in just a moment. Read. Go ahead.
And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep.
Okay, now I'm going to have to cut this thing up and expedite time. See, now when Moses comes back down here, see, there were 10 plagues poured out of the land of Egypt. Now, we want to let the last seven, the ninth plague, see, was stinging black darkness. That darkness covered the face of the deep. And you can see this Red Sea being a borderline, see, where the children of Israel, this is the seed of Abraham, see, that's going to spring forth from this state and condition, or from Egypt, see. Now, in order for the Israelites to come forth, see, Yahweh could have delivered them any way he wanted to breathe. Eyah what? Asher Eyah. I will be what I will be. Now, the seed of Abraham is being plagued down here, see, or have been made drunk, or have been made subject unto Pharaoh and his what? Host. That's Satan, see, or the devil incarnate in physical bodies. And all their false pagan idolatry, they are being subject and have been evilly entreated. Now, that's typified a psychological state of how we all was, being evilly entreated by these damnable spirits and lying ministers, you know what I'm saying? Making merchandise of our souls, you see what I'm saying? We have been made drunk, see? Now, for them to come up out of Egypt, see, Yahweh instituted, see, the Passover meal down here. This is the institution of the Passover meal. Now, it was unleavened bread, bitter herbs, see? See? And roast lamb there, see? Now, this lamb really didn't mean anything, see? Now, it's being set up as a type. It's the lamb, the children of Israel eating the lamb of this meal with the lamb therein. And this lamb is really pointing to the words of the Holy Spirit. Because Yahshua Messiah is the Lamb of Yahweh, see? See? And by partaking of his word, see? Or as Moses wrote, man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of Yahweh Elohim, see? See? So then it's this lamb physically, see? Physical lamb, four-legged lamb, is really pointing to the true two-legged, which is Yahshua Messiah. And see, the way we eat him is by the words of the Holy Spirit. That's why the Messiah said, unless you eat of my flesh and drink of my blood, you have no what? Life therein. And he had to eat all this lamb, see? See? Now, they were obedient, see? And this death angel came through and smote firstborn man and beast that did not have, see, the blood of the what? The blood of the lamb, see? See, so we see that Pharaoh, see, and his host is being overcome by the slaying of a lamb in the beginning of the migration, which correlates with the lamb that's slain from what? The foundation of the world. Now, this is a natural manifestation of Romans 1, 19 and 20, see? That's being taken place here. So they come through the divided waters of the Red Sea, again, that rod or that reed, see, rose up, typified Yahshua Messiah, and the children of Israel go through on what? Dry ground. This is the seed of Abraham. 3 days after this lamb is slain, see, they go through the divided waters of the Red Sea. Now, they had to take the blood and put it on the two side posts, put it on some basin in the door, see. Typified, see, Yahshua Messiah, now he's going to fulfill that. I'm talking about Jesus. Now, I read that. I knew that story just like by heart. But nobody never told me that the blood on the blood on the two side posts of the door, the top of the basin, see, on the inside of their houses, how this Messiah fulfilled it by being crucified in his left hand, right hand. That's the blood on the two side posts of the door. Blood on the top, see, and nails in his what? See, nails in his feet. That's 4 points of blood. Now, this is a lamb. This is a true lamb that's being slain.
That's right.
See, that's being fulfilled, pointing to this lamb down here in Egypt, see. So here we have the new creature being drawn out. Revelation 21 and 1. Come all the way down. Coming through the divided waters of the Red Sea. And so they're leaving, by the pattern, they're leaving the first heaven and the first what? Earth, see? And they're passing through the sea. And John said, hey, there ain't no more sea. Now, there's no more death and burial state. Right. Now I'm in the what? I'm in the resurrection. So this new creature is led by a phenomenal cloud, of the pillar of fire by night and the cloud by day. See? See, now Pharaoh and his host was cast down in the Red Sea when Moses was told the law of the rod again. That's that self-same reed again, see? Well, that measuring reed, see, is being lowered, see? And Pharaoh and his host was drowned down in the Red Sea. Now, they come back in this mountain here, and this is where they receive the oracles of Yahweh. Moses is shown the vision, and the law was written. They built this tabernacle out here, see? See? Now what we want to come to is this here, see? Now, we see how this here, this death, this burial, and this resurrection, see? And we have the new creature being drawn out, see? And then Moses goes up in the mountain, and he receives this reed or this rod. See, and he comes, after spending 40 days up here, he comes down, see, with his pattern and his hard mind, see, and John sees this and confirms this new creature being drawn out, see, out of this chaotic darkness, see, as you see pictorially illustrated. So you have the kingdom set up before the foundation of the world. Then you have this chaotic plate, see, correlated with the beginning of physical creation, which is also the beginning of migration, see. Now, these same principles have to repeat themselves, see, when Yahshua Messiah comes, see, which we'll get into in just a moment. Read.
Revelation 21. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth.
Now he said, now I saw a new heaven and a new earth. Read.
For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away.
See, once you leave this court roundabout, you pass the lake. Read. See, this is the first earth.
And there was no more sea.
See, once you pass this labor, there is no more what? Sea. See, just by the ages and dispensations, you can see then, after you can confirm it, see? 3 ages in time, they got to be framed by the what? By the pattern or by that measuring reed, see? And the 3 ages in time, I said in time, the antediluvian age, the post-diluvian age, and the present kingdom age, see? See, that's the court roundabout, holy place, mm-hmm. Most holy place. The flood would be the, what, first veil, see? See, and the Messiah's death, burial, and resurrection here, and the output would be the what? Second veil, see? Mm-hmm. See? And you got your sixth dispensation, I like it to the steps in the tabernacle there, see? Now, so then you can see then when Noah left this, the what? The antediluvian age. Now, that's the new creature in the ark, see? That's coming out of that chaotic what? See, that chaotic darkness, see?
That's right.
See, it rained 40 days and 40 nights. Now, you know what? No sunny day. You see that? Correlate. See, now all this is being lined up with the pattern. Because, see, when Yahshua Messiah comes in, and he's on the cross, see, from what? See, from 12 o'clock and from the sixth hour, or from 12 to 3, mm-hmm. see, it turns dark, see, over the face of the earth. Why? See, there's a change in age, or there's a change in the world, and that new creature, see, is getting ready to come forth, see, which we're going to get into in just a moment. Read.
And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from Yahweh out of heaven.
Come on.
Prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of Yahweh is with men.
Now here's this tabernacle which was camped out here, the children of Israel. This is New Jerusalem. Children of Israel camped around this what? Tabernacle, around their various banners. So even when the children of Israel were in Egypt, see, they were without shaven form because they didn't know their what? Their place around this what? Tabernacle. So everything was in a chaotic state. See, they're being drawn, the new creatures are being drawn out here. This is where Yahweh is taking on what? Shape and form. Oh, this is the new creature taking on shape and form as Yahweh left this pure spirit state and took in part and took on this form here. And then manifested in the concrete. Read.
And he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and Yahweh himself shall be with them and be their Elohim. And Yahweh shall wipe away all their tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying.
Okay, see, there was no more death here, that down here. See, now this really is pointing to Yahshua Messiah, which we have to get on down the line, see? The clock is on me, see? So then let me say this, see? Just hold that 20, I want to end up on that 21st chapter there. Now, as what we have here, see, is that the children of Israel spent some 40 years out here in the wilderness. And they mourned Moses' death. Moses died at the end of the 40 years. And they mourned Moses' death, what? 30 days. And 3 days, Joshua gave him 3 days to prepare what? Victual, because he's given charge. So 30 and 3 is what? 33. So that's a death. See? Mm-hmm. See? See, there's going to be a burial, and there also has to be a what? A resurrection of, again, 144,000. See? Mm-hmm. That 144,000, that's 144, that's 9. That's that new creature's taking on over on into the most holy place. Or Joshua is taking them back into perfection. See? Now I have to pick that up and hold that point right there for a moment. See? Now I got to go back to the garden. See? Where it all began as time began there. See? With Adam and Eve. See? Again, Adam is taken from the dust of the earth. That's that body. Elohim breathes into his nostrils the breath of life, making him a living what? Soul. That's in the holy place there. The division between body and soul there. See? Then he takes the man, places him in the garden, and gives him a law to govern him what? Therein, that he could eat of every tree in the garden except for the tree of knowledge of good and evil. For in the day that he eats of that tree, he shall surely what? Die. See, now the woman is taken out of the man, again, by DBR, or death, burial, or what? That's that new what? Creature. Now Eve would typify the new creature, see? And Adam would be the husband man. You see what I'm saying? Oh, that's the Yahshua Messiah. Now you watch. Mm-hmm. See? Now according to Yahweh's work, purpose, and will, we know it was 40 days that they had peace up there in perfection, see? Holy and innocent, see? Now the sacrifice has already been prepared from the foundation of the earth to atone for Adam's sins. Well, how do you know this? Because, see, down in the land of Egypt, see, this lamb here was slain before they built the golden calf out here. See, just like that, see, before they had this great, made this sin out here, the sacrifice has already been offered. Typified Yahshua Messiah,
that's
see.
Right.
Now you watch, see, now this woman receives a vision, see, or this glorious angel appears to her and say, what does Elohim say that you cannot eat every tree in the garden? He said, and he goes on to tell her, say, you shall not surely what?
Die.
See, now the woman is overwhelmed by his personage. Mm-hmm. You know, his personalities. You know, you get somebody like Michael Jackson walking and people just fall out. Bang! As everybody says, it's by the presence, see?
Yeah.
A star, see? Well, she was just totally overwhelmed, see? Mm-hmm. See? And then he began to work, see? See? Then he began to sow his words right into her what? Heart and her mind, see? See, and made her drunk, see? She began to have a desire, a strong lust for this tree. Mm-hmm. There's a tree to be desired to make her what? Wise. And she thought that by partaking of this physical tree, that she could be Elohim, when she was already made in the image and likeness of Elohim from the start. So here's the devil got her on a wild goose chase. You see what I'm saying? To become something that she already really was. But it was hidden, all its purpose at this time. So you can see that here's the new creature, Eve, see, the woman, being made subject, see? To the beast, or the dragon, with the seven heads and 10 horns that John saw in his vision that was cast out of heaven along with his what? See, along with his other creatures that believed his tale. So he overwhelmed the woman and she was made drunk or intoxicated. Now, you ain't never had no liquor to do that to you. Feel that good about that tree. See? See? But nevertheless, see? See? Nevertheless, she was totally overwhelmed, see? Spiritually and psychologically, see what I'm saying? And it resulted, see, in her death. Now, Adam willingly died for his what? Bride. Mm-hmm. Now, we're talking about a death that took place right there in the garden. No outward manifestations. You know what I'm saying? We're talking about those divine attributes, see? See, they have changed. See, you say, you know, you got 9 divine attributes. See, intelligent, the triads. See, that constitute or make up a man's what? Soul. And somebody said, well, how do you know that? Because you got 92 elements in the earth plane that make up this what? This physical body. There's 91, 3, 4 elements. You got 1, 2, 4. You know, hydrogen, gold, silver. Those things make up this body. And they are analogous in the earth plane, the 92 elements are analogous to the 9 divine attributes. See? Now, those attributes, see, as when they came in, they were in a chaotic state. See? So then, when Adam was placed in the garden, his heart and mind was not in a chaotic state. See, to be spiritually minded is what? Life and peace, but to be carnally minded is what? Death. Now, let me hold this. Now, remember, on the fourth day of Moses' vision, see, Yahweh told Moses this in Moses' vision. The sun and the moon was placed there in the sky, the two great lights, one to rule the day and one to rule the night. And the sun would cause the change in the what? Seasons. Now, he said, now, wait a minute. Adam was, all Adam knew was summer. Or he was in perfection or fruition. Typified him eating of the fruits of the spirit where? In his heart and his mind. These natural trees, physical trees up here. See, in a garden. Well, how do we know that? Because Adam, Noah had natural animals in that ark. And when Joshua led them in Canaan's land, they began to eat the fruit of what? Trees, see? And that's a physical resurrection because Adam and Eve made a what? Degeneration, see? So they died in their heart and mind. All these attributes became, they transformed, see? Intelligent, wisdom, knowledge, love, beauty, justice, foundation, power, and strength. And you got a great big there, you got a sun, what? Therein to govern the season, see? See, just as you got a sun in the sky that governs the 9 what? Planets in the solar system. See? Govern the seasons. See? Now watch the seasons change. See? This creature or this new creature is going to return to this chaotic state. But it coming not by what? Observation. See? The woman dies, see? Or to become carnally minded. That's what? Death. So that's a fall and what? Winter state. See? See, a fall and winter state, that's like it to a death and what? Death and burial. And what do you think is causing, see, the change in the season? It's the sun. Now, he ain't changing. They are what? Changing or being placed in a calm-minded state. See? Then they are finally driven out of the garden in the cool of the day. So Adam saw the seasons change, or he never knew night, but he saw it that night. See? I say he saw it that night. I'm talking about he saw it here first. See, and fled from the presence of what? Yahweh in the garden, and began to cover up. That's the nature of it as you got through reading the column. Where can you flee from the presence of Yahweh as you got through reading the scripture lesson? Now, Adam is driven out. This is a degeneration, and he's populating. He has all the genetic material that's going to populate the earth. So the seasons change, the leaves change, and everything changed to reflect the Son of Yahweh dying in the sky. So when Adam died, the sun and the God, the S-U-N, went down to reflect the S what? It's the son of Adam dying, see? Now Adam lived, see? One day with Yahweh is the same as a what? See, one day is the same as a thousand years, see? 900, Adam lived his natural life, 900 what?
30
years. That's 70 years short of a day. But those 930 years, even though he's populating the earth, are reproducing down here, see? See, after the flesh. Up here was in the spirit, see, down here he's making baby tabernacles. You understand that, don't you? Anybody got no understanding, you know what I'm saying? Making these things here. And see, carbon copies, see, they populated this thing, you see what I'm saying? See, making, being the mother and father of all flesh, see, now the whole earth changed. So now after Adam and Eve began to populate the earth, it didn't get no better because they are the parents of this what? State of mind. The condition just got what? Worser and worser. And one man, Noah, was chosen out. See? And he received a vision. See that it was going to rain. See? Because what do you do with the dead man? By the pattern, you got to bury it. See? Mm-hmm. And this new creature has to be drawn out in only 8 when they are. And what about the transformation? So before the age changed, now you listen very carefully. Noah preached for 120 years that it was going to rain. See, now you had to believe that by faith, or have Yahweh show it to you. You see what I'm saying? Now you had to be changed, see, or become a new creature before the physical manifestation was brought in. See, so here you have the eight souls that are in the ark, Noah's preaching, the blood, placing the blood on their head, see, warning the people. See, now just eating these words will result in changing your heart and mind, or you become obedient, see, and be spared just by believing the words of Noah. And the word Noah means comforter. He's a type of the Messiah at the end, and that age was wicked, see, because of the doctrine that Cain taught there in the city of Cain. It was destroyed in the flood, so then the new creature comes over. See, and that new creature that's drawn out of that chaotic darkness, see, or that ark resurrected atop Mount Arab, see, with all the beasts of the field, see, in that ark. And our ark typifies the body of what? Yahshua the Messiah. So you've got a whole brand new world, see, a brand new age, see, coming out of there. It didn't last long because Nimrod caused him to violate the what? See, the Noahic covenant by building a tower of what? Babel, see, now if they had known by the pattern wasn't given at that time, see, Yahweh revealed the pattern in the post-Diluvian age, see, once you pass the labor, see, there is no more what? There is no more sea. That's why he asked, well, there was no more flood, see. Now we come all the way down, see, the promise that was given to Abraham, we come on down to truly Yahshua the Messiah. Now what he's redoing now, see, since this law was given, see, to these Jews and Jews only, it was a spiritual law, but the people were calm-minded, see. And what this law did was just magnify this calm-minded state, or this fall and winter what? State. Now this state lasted, well, how long did this state last? It lasted for four what? It lasted for 4 days, the same as what? 4,000 years. Now get me John 11:24, 11:25. See, so that death reigned from Adam down to Messiah 4 days, because the sun is placed in the sky on the fourth day. Now there has to be a change in the seasons, because Adam caused the change, the season to change from summer to fall and what? Fall and winter. Right here in his hard mind, he went from a spiritual minded state of being at peace with Yahweh. What do you mean being at peace with Yahweh? Well, the wrath of Yahweh didn't descend upon him. Sorrow, woe, and what? You see how this man is state of condition, this man's hard mind, see? Sorrow, woe, and grief. See? Or he's being condemned. See, by that law within his own hard mind. See, now it rained for, that death strike rained for 4,000 years. Or winter lasted, fall and winter, or men were all dead and buried. See, for 4,000 years. See, then come Yahshua Messiah, the mission of John the Baptist, to bury these dead what? Jews. See, this is what Yahshua Messiah comes in. Read.
John 11:24.
Read.
Martha saith unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day.
Read.
Yahshua said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life.
Now here's this word, or here is the resurrected, or since Yahshua the Messiah, which is Yahweh Elohim. Now he's the first to resurrect out of this apparent darkness. I didn't say Yahweh was darkness. In his pure spirit state to us he is. You see what I'm saying? It's just like taking a fertilized ovum. See, that's inscrutable, incomprehensible. You can't tell whether that's male or female. If you went to and took it to an egg to a doctor and asked, this is a male or female chicken egg. It's some kind of fool you think I am. You better sit in there somewhere and let this hen hatch it for 21 days or put it in a woman for 9 months and wait till they come out and we'll see what we got. But we ain't going to sit here and scrutinize and debate and figure out, try to imagine what this is, because it's inscrutable and incomprehensible, and that's what? State and condition. See, so he's being drawn out, see? So Elohim took on this shape and form, so the baby takes on shape and form in the mother's womb for 40 what? 40 weeks. See, that's that shape and form, see? This is the children of Israel coming out of this apparent dark, see? See, now here's Yahshua the Messiah. Now Israel, see, that whole body of Israel, look at it as his parent mass. See, all of Israel is dead. And he said, I am the resurrection and the life. And everybody else is dead in the what? Don't kneel. All ready for the morgue. She said, the mortician. You see what I'm saying? So then they had to have the mortician out there. That's John the Baptist. See, he's out there to bury him. See? See, now there's going to be a change in the season. See? Are we talking about a regeneration or coming back into this day? See? See? Now we showed forth that when Joshua went over, see, he met an angel there. See? See? And he was told to take off his shoes. But then when Joshua got over, remember he fought 40 years in Canaan's land. But the point I want to make is when Joshua led the 144,000, see, he caused the sun to what? Stand still, see? See, in the moon in the valley of Ajalon. And the 10th chapter of Joshua said there was never a day like it on that day where the sun hearkened unto a voice of a what? Of a man. See, now that was Yahweh Elohim in a body, so he's leading the children of Israel back into the day where Adam and Eve was where? In the beginning. That's a natural little manifestation. That's not the reality. Now here's Yahshua the Messiah, which is the reality. He said, now I'm the resurrection. I'm the life. And this law here was the law of what? Sin and death. It could not make a man perfect as pertaining to his consciousness. We're talking about trying. Now you are lying and a hypocrite. See, to say that you can take some water, or Lord's Supper, that's gonna remove you lying so much. You got hate in your heart, mind. Now you can even go down and have a lobotomy. You know, have part of your brain taken out. That still ain't gonna quit you from being lying.
That's right.
You see what I'm saying? That's your most holy place. You know what I'm saying? That's not gonna change. Because we're talking about the change of this inner what? This inner man. And the state of the inner man by the pattern is in a fall and one state. See, and what it needs is a what? Here he is. That's Yahshua Messiah. He's the resurrection. To resurrect the what? The whole body of Israel. And how is he going to go through it? Now, he's slain out there, see, in Golgotha. Why Golgotha? Because the man died in the what? See, he died in the skull, see? There in the God, see? We're talking about the change of these attributes. You see what I'm saying? He's buried in Joseph's new tomb, see? And see, when he's buried in a garden. See? Why does he have to be? Because Adam died in a garden. See? He died right in a garden, so when Yahshua Messiah is crucified and buried, he's buried in a garden. See? And you got a guard here, right here. See? It's either sowing tares or wheat or fruits of the Spirit. It don't take us no long time to figure out which one it is. You see what I'm saying? We're talking about spiritually, what? Psychologically. See, what you going to manifest? So then, it turned dark over the face of the earth again. Changing the world, changing the what? Age. He's buried in Joseph's new tomb. Now give me Matthew 27:51. See, and it had already been prophesied. See, in the law. Here's the law of this resurrection. In the prophecy, we had the Ezekiel about the valley of what? Dry bones. See? And them bones represents the soul of what? Israel. See? In that death and what? Burial state. See? Now after this flesh rots off, you got these bones. See? And the bones was likened to the inner man. See, now we don't have no long time, see, for it to be revealed in us, this new creature. Because, see, when Adam saw the creation of the new heaven, old heaven and earth in a vision, see, on top of Mount Sinai, now for you to see the new creature, in you, it coming by what? By vision and revelation. Yahshua had to see that you have been regenerated spiritually and psychologically. That don't come by observation. See, you ain't got no new flesh. See, we're talking about those that inner man regenerated where it's going to bear forth the fruit, peace, joy, love, those things. Mm-hmm. And the only way it can be done, we're going to show forth is by the preaching. It has to be spoken. And people say, well, how do you know that? Because Elohim spoke 7 times here. See? And he had a new what? He had a new creation come forth. See? And that was the apostles' job there. See? After they had received the Holy Spirit, just go out and speak to Israel. Just speak. Don't work. Just speak, and all of a sudden, what you have a transformation, see, that will take place, see, in an individual's heart if they believe. You see what I'm saying? Matthew 27:51.
And behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain.
Now that veil, see, now when Adam died, that's that veil of the flesh that come off, see? Now Yahshua Messiah, see, he rent that veil. He's crucified, buried at Joseph's new tomb. Now look, all these souls, from Adam down to John the Baptist, see, they remain in this first heaven. We're talking about spirit, see? Couldn't nobody resurrect before the Father because there had not been any what? Atonement, see? Now listen, did no chanting, burning no candles, or anything else get them out of Egypt down here? From a natural standpoint, so as you burning no candles, chanting, beads, and anything else, it just ain't gonna work. See? And look, that song said, see, pharmaceutical extracts just ain't gonna help you.
That's right.
You see what I'm saying? See, that's temple. We're talking about changing. I don't know a pharmaceutical drug that can remove hate and malice and strife.
That's right.
See, see what I'm saying? Now, if you do, tell us then. See? The whole world, you'll be a billionaire overnight. See? So ain't no natural drug going to bring about that transformation. It's only the words of the Holy Spirit that's going to transform that consciousness.
That's right.
That's the preaching of the truth. The Messiah said, and ye shall know the truth. And it's this truth that's going to set you free.
Mm-hmm.
See? Now listen, when you've been set free, just like over in South Africa, that's a natural manifestation. If I said, well, look, all them black folks in jail, working in the gold mines and working hard over there. Everybody said, they should be set free, but they ain't never looked at who got them in bondage. They're Christians. See, you see what I'm saying? That's just a natural manifestation. Here we over in America, walking around, people say, I'm free. Well, why are you giving 10% of your tithes to the preacher? You see what I'm saying? See? Why are you sitting down there arguing about abortion? You see? All those things have been placed on them by what? By very religious what? Teachers. You see what I'm saying? I'm trying to show you what, how people have been made what? Drunk. See? Okay, finish on that. Read.
And behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom.
Read.
And the earth did quake, and the rocks rent.
The rocks did rent. Read.
And the graves were opened.
Read. And the graves, see, now the veil that rent, that's that what? Second veil. When the earthquake rent, that's that what? That's that first veil, see? And what comes up is these spirits. See, read.
And the graves were opened.
And the graves were opened.
And many bodies of the sons which slept arose. And came out of the graves after his resurrection.
Okay, now they came out of his grave after his resurrection. Read on.
And went into the holy city and appeared unto many.
Now okay, wait, that's all we need. Now get me to the 20th chapter of Revelation. So then when they went into the holy city, they tarried all day. And that day of the resurrection was that thousand what? That is that thousand year day that the Messiah have resurrected them back unto. See, this is a degeneration, and Adam is a what? Regeneration. See? So that they back into the day. And during that same day of the resurrection, the scribes and Pharisees are in the tomb, in the temple here. See? In their graves or in their temples, devising a lie to tell the people concerning Yahshua's what? Resurrection. See? Now, already the devil's begin to work. See? Now, this devil's going to come out with a lie. See? And this beast is going to be turned loose on this creature, the new creature, the woman again. But this time, we ain't going to go through that one more time like you did up here. But see, I took the woman out of the what? Out of the man, see? Now get me that in the 12th chapter of Revelation where it said the dragon persecuted the woman. See this dragon here? But now the woman now is clothed where? In the sun, see? Now the devil can kill the body, but not the what? Not the soul or transform this. The Messiah said, I'm the resurrection of life. He that believes on me shall what? Shall have everlasting life. And he that, you know, he that once dead shall be alive, and he that's alive is alive forevermore. So now once you being dead, being resurrected spiritually, see, then you have resurrected. So you see that the seasons have changed. They went from fall and winter. Here's the Messiah. Here's at the spring. It's a resurrection. And now we're in the summer. Now we're at the end of the summer. See, we're at the end of the whole thing, see. And people are wandering around here, do they have the Holy Spirit or don't they have it, see. Now, you know right here in your own world, we're talking about within this universe here. Mm-hmm. See, whether it's in a chaotic state, you know, you look out there in the universe, and you see these planets, they have the environment is hostile. They have to send a probe in there. Look, you go right around here in Chicago, you see people frowning, hostile. See, you got to send a probe in there. You see what I'm saying? You said you can set them off. They're violent, full of undamnable spirits, see, in their world, see. Now, everybody, if you're honest with yourself, if you ask that boy, it'll tell you what state and condition that you're in. See? We're talking about being regenerated spiritually and psychologically. Now, read that scripture, that I want. Give me just that Revelation. How many minutes I got? Five. Read that.
Revelation 12:13.
Read.
And when the dragon saw that he was cast into the earth, he persecuted the woman who brought forth the male child.
Okay, that's all I want to read. See? Now, listen. Now, here's the dragon. See? That's persecuting the woman, the man child. As Adam was a type, Moses was a type of the man child, truly it's Yahshua Messiah in us. That's that what? That's that man child that's being regenerated right here. The sun is, the day star is rising in our heart and in our mind.
Right.
See, now that's what the apostles were supposed to do. See, as they went out and preached to this new creature. See, and brought about a what? A regeneration of our souls. And this vision at the end of this age. See, it delivered us out of mystery Babylon, out of confusion, spiritually and psychologically. See, and then we have to examine ourselves and see whether hate, malice, and strife, have subsided, or we have went from fall and winter to a spring and summer.
Right.
As I told the Jamaicans when I come down, that I went down there, you know, I says, look, I said, this is a poor country, and it's only a type and shadow of, I said, you always want to know like this, what it is to walk through a calm mind. All you got to do is go into the poorest neighborhood, and look at it, and that's now you see all the filth. And people can't stand that. That's just a type and shadow of what's in a man's what? That's just a natural manifestation. I said, now we're down here, it's by the preaching of this vision, the Holy Spirit will resurrect or regenerate you. Now you can be poor as a church mouse, but that new creature, See, we'll live on in ages to come in glorification. Now you have a choice. Now this is why Paul said, examine yourself and see whether you be in the faith. Look, in this fifth age, the new earth, new heaven, new earth state, how you leave here is how you remain. See, and this whole universe is a great big universal womb. See, now the resurrection has already come. See, as a matter of fact, we're almost at the end of the resurrection. Now the Messiah has abolished death, spiritual death, and brought about a transformation, and you walking around here. See, in what state and condition? This is the scripture I want to read. I think it's what about that Jeremiah where it says that Balaam and Gilead, is there no healing? And I think it's Jeremiah I think it's the 8th or 9th chapter, the last 2 or 3 verses. See, well, the class in Jamaica has truly gone because thanks be to Yahweh, what we did is, it was an assembly down of Yahweh, that they were all transformed in this teaching. The class is down there about 50 or 60 people. See, and to see what Yahweh has done and in such a quick time, me and Dr. Mixon were down there about July 15th. We couldn't believe, my mouth dropped open and hit the floor to see that these people expound in such a, you'd think they'd been in class 10 or 15 years. That's the power of all Yahweh did was speak to this pan mass. You speak to it, just leave it alone, because the sign of what? The sign will follow, see? So now how are we going to transform that carnal mind? It's like we did this pan mass, just speak to it. Now if it don't, if you, in other words, what we're saying, if you leave here in a fallen winter state, that's how you remain throughout what? Eternity in a fallen winter state. There is no resurrection. There is no part for you in the new heaven and new earth state. Because under the law, the children of Israel, when they became unclean outside of what they went, they were outside the camp for 7 days, see? Here that took place where? In the holy place. So we all have to make sure whether our election is sure. Now don't go over and guessing and hoping. It's like, you're throwing dice, I hoping, come on, 7. See, it ain't like that. You hoping and praying and all, it ain't like that. It can be revealed right there where? In you. And listen, even a blind man can tell the seasons. He can tell day from night by the warm rays of the what? Sun, see? Now we're talking about now, and listen, you look within you, and if you should see some type of change. Now don't nobody know. You the true one to truly know. All we see is the manifestation. Now you listen to this. Whatever you manifest, we only see 10% of it. Just like a big iceberg, you don't see the top of it. You see hating somebody, you don't see the top part of it. The rest of it is all within these attributes. You see what I'm saying? These attributes are either giving off peace, joy, and righteousness, or they're in a calm mind state giving off thorns and what? Thorns and thistles. That's a permanent state, folks. That's eternal. So that's why I says, no more fooling around and playing games. That's see? Right. See? True. See? Oh, we are at the very end, see? And as Dr. Harris for 7 years, this is 1960. That's why all the 60s, everything is back, it's in the 60s again. Why? Because we're in 1960 again. Mm-hmm. They don't understand. They ain't got long. See? And so we don't have long. Let's read it and I'll be finished. But like I say, it's tremendous to see the power of the Holy Spirit. I ain't talking about a man. Paul said, one man planted, another man water, but Yahweh is what?
Increase.
You speak and you don't think it ain't got no effect. You say, well, I don't know. Dog, he ain't changed. You go somewhere and sit down somewhere and forget about it. Next thing you know, you're astounded at what didn't been manifested. See, showing forth the Holy Spirit is brought about a transformation, but not in the time that you expected. See, the Holy Spirit has his time for the change of the season, as he told them at their ascension. It's not for you to know the time or the what? See, the season. See, well, we're at the end, folks. No more playing games. You have to really look here in the heart. Now, don't worry about nobody else's house.
Really?
See, you get your house ready.
That's
see?
Right. That's right.
You're in the hospital. You don't go there for nobody else. You go for yourself. Read.
Jeremiah 8:22.
Read.
Is there no balm in Gilead?
Now look, here we sit up under the truth. See, they say, is that, now a lot of confusion shouldn't be manifested. In other words, what we're saying, if we're all dead here, we say the Messiah's death is in what? In vain, because this death, burial, and resurrection brought about a transformation of a man's what? Heart and mind. He has abolished death. So what's our excuse? What's everybody's excuse for being what? Dead, because you got the truth, and the true gospel is being preached. And we've been around the world, so why, if the Christendom said they have it, then why have we got so much confusion in the world? They have been made drunk again, see? Read.
Is there no balm in Gilead? Is there no physician there?
Read.
Why then is not the health of the daughter of my people recovered?
That's what we're looking for. You're looking for recovery. Read.
Oh, that my head were waters and mine eyes a fountain of tears.
Okay, that's all I want. So in other words, we're saying, folks, listen. We're at an end of an age, see?
Yeah.
See, truly. And things, they don't get no better. And so we really have to walk and talk and hear that voice that's speaking from what? Heaven. Right here in our heart and our mind. See, and that's communing with Yahshua. Because you're only in class 6 hours a day, you know, 6 hours a week, eight, ten, say 12 hours a week. What you doing in the meantime? Who's the teacher?
That's right. That's
the teacher is the Holy Spirit in you. And that's what's going to exercise self-control or keep this world in order. Now, we don't want it to degenerate into chaos. See, so what's keeping it is that law of the Spirit of life. And as John said, the Messiah said, behold, I've made all things new. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon again. I hope everybody enjoyed the previous two videos that our class has shared today. We hope that we keep in memory these things that we've learned over the years. Going back this past month here in November, recanting some of the videos of previous speakers of times past, knowing here Lee Warren passed away here on the 14th, I believe, of October. So we recognize the preaching and the teaching by the vessels that have heard this great teaching. And we want to continue in the same vein that we've been taught as they've been taught by the Holy Spirit. And before we conclude class with the doxology, just want to encourage everyone to keep following us. Join our class through their website of thearchetypepattern.com. Sign up so that you can receive the emails and the notifications of how we are kind of transforming ourselves out of one state into another as these times approaches that may be different situations whereby we're trying to get organized and whereby we can continue in a live fashion, live streaming. Through YouTube, Zoom, Facebook, Twitch, and other such medias that Yahweh has provided for us to preach to the gospel to all the world. And with that, no other comments. Again, join us, like our videos, and sign up so that you can get the information and also learn how to donate as your heart desires. With that, let's end in our hearts and minds with the doxology, if you will stand. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, beyond glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time and now and ever, let us all say, Hallelujah.
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 This was good. I visited